Let's all stand for the reading of God's word, please. And the scripture reading today is from the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 12, verses 12 to 20. So when we reach verse 18, let's read together. Okay, so I'll cue you when we reach that point. All right. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one spirit we were all baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slaves or free, and all were made to drink of one spirit. For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot should say, "Because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body," that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear should say, "Because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body," that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would be the sense of hearing? If the whole body were an ear, where would be the sense of smell? Let's read the rest together, please. But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them, as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, yet one body. This is the word of God. And let's, as Pastor Doug shares with us about this passage, let's seek to give our minds to listen to what he's saying and our hearts to God as we listen. Please be seated.
We've just had a living illustration of what Paul was expressing to the church at Corinth. When the handbell choir was playing, I noticed that everybody was playing on the same page, that everybody was coordinated together, that there was a direction going on, and the handbell choir was just kind of putting everything together, much like gears meshing together, and it was beautiful. And not only that, but when you look at the entirety of all that takes place every Sunday morning, when we have different people who are participating in the different ministries that we have here, thinking about our worship time and thinking about all the activities that we have, we are seeing this wonderful picture of a body functioning together in unity and in harmony and for a purpose. Now, the Apostle Paul was speaking in the scripture, was writing, I guess I should say, to the church at Corinth. And this church was one that was not quite as well coordinated and not as unified as we are here. They were a church that was struggling, and they were on the verge of losing their spiritual identity because of their inner factionalism. The Apostle Paul was calling them in the earlier part of this chapter from last week. If you remember, I spoke about gifts, spoke about the different gifts that God has liberally and generously given unto his church. And yet the very gifts that God had given to the church, to the different members of the church, those gifts had become issues of contention and dissension as the underlying unity in Christ was being ignored. And the Apostle Paul was calling to the church in his letter in chapter 12, he was calling them to remember the unity that and the unity of love, that spirit of love that must permeate and integrate and undergird every expression of spiritual giftedness. I believe we have something that I want us to see, just a very brief, and I'll ask if the big lights could be turned off so we can see this well, please. All the big lights, thanks. Was calling to the church to open the giftedness that they had been given, but to offer that giftedness as unto the Lord, not as a possession, not as a right, not as something they deserved, but just as they received the Lord Jesus, in the same way receiving their place, their giftedness, and to serve others just as Jesus modeled on the cross, that gifts are for the body. Now, in this passage of scripture, in verses 12 and 13, we find that the body is one. Many, many members, but it is one, united. Notice, if you will, on the screen, and if you have it in your bulletin, notice the number of times that one is written. Notice, one body, okay, it's one. Notice that we're one spirit. Notice that we've all been made to drink of one spirit. Unified together in Christ. This, the Apostle Paul is kind of changing his analogy now. He's moving from gifts to body. He's using an illustration that anybody could understand. Using that illustration, by the way, underneath the illumination and inspiration of the Holy Spirit, he just didn't sit around one day and say, I think I'll write a letter and let me see what I can say and what. No, he was speaking with the inspiration of the Spirit, and he was writing to this church as their founding father, calling them to unity in Christ. Unity. Now, this purpose, it's a unity that has to deal with it, in calling the church to remember the price that was paid for them as well. This price, do you remember chapter 11? When they took the Lord's Supper, what were they doing? Those of you who have been following along, you'll remember that, wow, when they took the Lord's Supper, it wasn't like we do it here. They would have a big feast, and what was going on? Those who were up and in, they were eating all the food, they were getting drunk, and the down and out were not finding anything for them to be able to celebrate with, and they were calling this the Lord's Supper. And the Apostle Paul was reminding them that the brokenness of Christ, the purpose of that brokenness was that they might find unity with Him and in Him and with one another, even as He was united in the purpose of His Father of coming to this earth to give His life as a ransom for many. As last week, as I said, last week was an unstated assumption or an implicit assumption. I want to state it out clearly, that in order to discover your own personal value, the assumption is that you will find this only in Christ. You will find this only when you've come to the place that you recognize that without Him, this pursuit of personal value only leads you to more and more futility. When you come to the place of understanding that inside of you, there's a need that cannot be filled or cannot be met. There's an empty spot that cannot be filled, and all that you've done to satisfy that has not been enough. And you've heard the good news of the gospel that Christ died on the cross for your sin, and you understand that the problem is sin and that sin needs to be forgiven, and you've taken Jesus as your own. You've repented of that sin. That means you turned away from it, and you have received this gift of eternal life, and you're living all the the days of your life for Jesus. That is the underlying assumption with which this whole message and last week's message is supposed to portray. Gifts. These spiritual gifts, only in Christ. You will never find your personal value. You'll never discover it by yourself. You can only discover it when you are united in Christ and when you are walking with other brothers and sisters in close communion. Because you see, there's something about the way God has put the body together that we don't really know who we are until we find ourselves in Christ, and then we don't really discover so much about ourselves until we are connected up with one another as part of the body functioning for the glory of God. The provision and the purpose. God's purpose in placing the parts of the body was never that we would have uniformity or that we would conform to a given pattern of only one part of the body. God's provision is for us to grow as a body. We grow together in Christ. We grow together in discovering our own personal value. We grow together in knowing who we are and who our brothers and sisters are. And as this process develops, then we more clearly can appreciate all that God has done for us in Christ Jesus. God's purpose is unity, not conformity. God's purpose is unity in diversity. That means that we are so different and in so many ways. And wow, when I look out in this congregation and I see people from literally around the world, I think, what an awesome God we have, that He has people sprinkled all throughout the earth and God brings them together here, and we have literally members of our local body from around the world. And I praise His name for that. They're all very different. We're all very different. Even our staff is from all over the world. And yet God brings us together in unity and harmony and in love. God's purpose in that diversity is not division. It is not division. God's purpose never is division of the body. God's purpose is always that we would celebrate one another and celebrate His majesty and His plan as He's put together all the wonderful component parts in that body that we are. All the members, every one of us is important. Every part of my body is important. Every one. I cannot say that there's anybody who is part of our fellowship that is unimportant. Every person has equal dignity. Every person has their own unique place to fill and part to play in what God is doing among us as a people. Just like the Apostle Paul was calling the church at Corinth to understand that they too, every one of them, had a particular function and had a particular place. And without them fulfilling their function, the body itself could not fulfill its purpose. All the members, everyone in unity, everyone functioning in harmony and in love, allowing the Holy Spirit to move in the midst, just as our blood goes through every part of our body, providing nutrition, providing oxygen, keeping us alive. In the same way, the Holy Spirit moves among the body of Christ, His people. We, as His body, we're dependent upon Him. Now, the Scripture says, can the foot say, I don't know if I really belong here because, you know, I'm not a hand. I'm not a hand. I don't know. I don't know if I belong. What about the ear? Well, you know, if everything was an ear, well, if everything was an eye, where would the ear be? You see, we're all part of one another. We're all different, and we're all the same in the body of Christ. Which one are we? Yes, both the same and different simultaneously. There's no way that I could have ever done this down here. I don't know if Juliet, Sister Juliet, has enough time to train me how to even play one of these things. That's not within my area of giftedness at all. I know I couldn't sing and lead the music as our brother Armand. There's no way this could happen. It just couldn't happen. But you see, when we are placed in the body and we're functioning according to His plan and our giftedness, and when all of this is coming together in harmony, then we have unity in diversity. Now let's see the eye. I made a picture of an eye because, you know, if the ear should say, I'm not an eye, therefore I don't really belong. I'm not really important. Not important. Not important. Now, I understand sometimes that we get a little weary. Me too. Sometimes the most spiritual thing I can do is lay down and take a nap. And I know it's time to do that when Brenda tells me. Says, lay down, honey. It's time for you to rest. I say, yes, ma'am. And I go lay down because she knows me better than I know myself. There are times we get weary. I know that. But have you ever thought about what it would be like if the parts of our physical bodies acted sometimes like our spiritual body does? Can you imagine the heart saying, man, I'm just stuck in a rut. All these years, all I do is beat and beat, lub-dub, 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 lub-dub. I'm tired of it. It's time for somebody else to step up and pump the blood. Somebody else do the job. Okay, feet, it's up to you. Now come up here and pump this blood. Could not happen. Or perhaps the lungs say, you know, we're so underappreciated around here. You know, I don't think the other organs realize just how important we really are. If we quit doing our job for just a few minutes, everybody's going to see how valuable we really are. The brain, that brain thinks he's big stuff, does he? Well, let him do without some oxygen for just a little while, and let's see how important he really is. And the liver says, hey, I get to do all the dirty work. You think it's fun making bile? I've been doing this for all these years, and has anybody ever asked me to make any decisions or pump any blood or perform any functions? No, all I do, anything that's noticeable outside the body, no, all I do is just produce bile, and that's all I do, and I get a little tired sometimes. Some of us, we feel like we're an appendix on the body. You know, it's just in recent years, that the function of the appendix has been researched and established. People used to think that the appendix was just kind of extra pieces or an extra part and had no real purpose. But you know, the appendix, it's like this. The appendix provides a vital function of basically rebooting your whole digestive system with the positive, good bacteria after maybe you've had dysentery or cholera or something like that. It kind of reboots all of your digestive tract. All those good things are found there. It's like a storehouse. Not important? No. Every part is important. Every part is important. There's something that happens when there's two things called rejection and projection. Rejection of who we are. We don't want to be who we are. We want something else in the body. We want to be maybe more noticed. You know, we begin to compare ourselves and say, now wait a minute, I'm not getting the attention that so-and-so gets, and I don't have the visibility that so-and-so has, and why should I not have this same thing? This comparison process is a tremendous threat to the body of Christ. Because you see, there are no unimportant parts. Every part has been placed in the body just like Christ wants those parts placed in the body. And what makes every part important is not the placement, it is the placer, the one who has placed us in the body and called us to function in his plan in accordance with the way he's put us together. Dissatisfaction can set in when we compare ourselves and we begin to think, wait a minute, I'm not this or I'm not that. And I understand comparison. I understand that people like to compare themselves, and there's a, you know, kind of say, it's that kind of idea. And I understand that. And in your schooling and you know, we're comparing how much, what kind of car do we drive, and on and on and on. But when it comes to the family of God, we are not to compare ourselves with one another. Rather, comparing ourselves to what the Lord wants out of us and asking the question, Lord, am I functioning just the way you want me to function? Here's what happens. It's kind of a process. Comparison, dissatisfaction, resentment. I don't like it because I'm not somebody else. I should be somebody else. I deserve more. After all, do I not have a doctor's degree? After all, do I not teach at a college or a university? I deserve more. Because, you know, I am more. And why is my uniqueness here and my specialty, why is it not recognized? And then what sets in is dissension. After that, I should be noticed more. Instead of all the glory and all the praise and all the honor going to the only one who's worthy of it, the one who's placed us in that body. Sometimes, you know, we have that rejection of who we are. There's something that is much better than just that. You see, when we compare ourselves, when we see what others have or do, we measure ourselves against them, and we can be sure that we're all the time looking down upon ourselves, and we think others look down upon us because we don't have a, quote, position, unquote. Let me give you an illustration. It comes from way back in my past. One of my professors, I'll not name him, long time ago, he's with the Lord now, and he was one who liked everybody to know that he was somebody. Have you ever met anybody like that? I've met some people that way. They kind of remind me of a peacock. You know how a peacock struts in pride? Hey, look at me. I'm pretty. Let me spread out those tail feathers. See how pretty I am? Huh? Well, this was a good man. He really was. Knew much about the Bible. Probably knew more than I will ever know. But you know, knowledge is one thing and application is quite another. I was walking across the campus and I looked at him. I said, good morning, doctor. And I called his name. He turned around at me and said, is that all I get? Mister? I said, excuse me. I said, number one, I did say doctor. I said, but number two, you are right. You know, I really did discount you. I'm so sorry. I should have called you brother. You see? It's what happens when you're looking down upon yourself and wanting others to look up to you, and you don't know your place in the body. God's given us a protection. It's a wonderful protection. It's a protection that calls us away from much of the madness that can easily permeate our being. This protection is an attitude. It's an attitude of being interdependent. You see, most Americans are very independent. I'm an American. I can speak about Americans. Most Americans are very independent. Probably way too independent for our own good. Honestly, that's something that's a cultural characteristic of Americans. Very, very, very independent. And why is that? Because we, in our culture, we equate maturity with independence. You see, if I'm independent, it means that I am mature. And who wants to be immature? And so we are very independent in the way we go about things. The problem is when that attitude is brought into the body of Christ, there's like a virus that infects the body. You see, there's a protection. That protection is called interdependence. We need one another. In the body of Christ, there is a mutual need. Every part of the body needs every other part of the body. What happens if a part of the body is not there? Well, there's a story that is told by Donald Gray Barnhouse. He's a great preacher from yesteryear. He was in Philadelphia, I think it was the 10th Street Presbyterian Church, a great speaker. He talked about two law students who graduated from the Chicago Kent School of Law. The highest ranking student in the class was a blind man named Overton. And when he received his honor, he insisted that half of the credit should go to his friend, Kasperzak. You see, they met one another in school, and when the Mr. Kasperzak was armless, he guided the blind Mr. Overton down the stairs, and they became fast friends. The blind man carried the books, which the armless man read aloud in their common study, and so they planned to practice law together. Did you get that? A blind man reading, carrying books, and an armless man reading the law books to the blind man. And they graduated 1 and 2 in their class. They needed one another. But you see, each of them was missing something. In the same way, interdependence. We recognize we need one another. None of us is complete within ourselves. Every one of us has a spiritual gift and a function to play in the body. But no one of us can do it by ourselves. This is why you need your local church. This is why every one of you who is not a member of this church or another church, you need to plant your life in this church and grow in Christ with others. Because without you, this church is incomplete. And without this church, you are incomplete. This is why every one of us, in order to grow the best way possible, we need one another. Whether you're here for 6 months, or you're here for a year or 2 years to plug your life into this fellowship and grow, because this body continues to evolve and change, and the gift that you bring is that which God has for us, and He wants you to open that gift, plug your part of giftedness into this body, and thrive with us. Not just survive, not just ride the waves, not just do a Sunday morning thing, tip your hat to God, but to plug your life in to the family of God so that the fullness of God's Spirit might flow into you and through you unto others. That's what it means. That's the protection that God has given. You see, if everything was like an eye, where would the sense of smell be? We wouldn't have it, would we? Many members, one body. I'm talking about the local body. You may be saying, well, I belong to Jesus and I'm a member someplace else. Wonderful. I'm part of the universal church. Hallelujah. I praise God for your conversion. I praise God for that. But hear me say that everything that the Apostle Paul was speaking about was directed to a local church. And it's not a case of either or, it's a case of both and. Making our lives count where we are for Christ's sake. Making our lives count through the body of Christ. Many members, one body. This one man, tremendous, tremendous, this man, Dr. Blobel, he won the Nobel Peace, the Nobel Prize, because he understood the principle of interdependence. He said, it's the key to understanding nature's system. I don't like the word nature, I would say creation, but that's what he said. The best example is the human body. You see, all the cells in the human body connect and interconnect, and they mutually give for the benefit of the entire body. What every cell needs to exist, and it applies the rest of its strength, they're mutually feeding one another. That's what it means to be part of the local body of Christ. This is why it's vital what Pastor Nick is doing and what Peter Shannon is doing as we are developing disciples so that they may be growing members in this body so that we can fulfill our ultimate purpose, which is to glorify our Lord God by reaching further and further outside of ourselves with the gospel into the different lands that we go to. For you see, the reality is this: we can reach no further out than what we have first allowed Him to reach in to us. And when He reaches into us and we're part of His body, then we are able to reach out further and further for the glory of God, sharing the gospel, the good news of Jesus, with the world. For you see, that's God's ultimate purpose. It's not just be a body. It's be a body that's on mission, that has a unity with it, a united purpose of sharing the good news of Jesus. Just like my body's united purpose is so that I might serve God where He leads. Levels of maturity. I think I've spoken to that. Projection. Now, this is another big one. Oh, my. I call it the big eye, little you syndrome. Hey, look me over. I'm something. If you just had my gift, if you just had my place, man, you'd be special too. You'd be special. You want to be special? Just be like me. Be special. I mean, you know, after all, look at me. Aren't I the model for which everyone needs to pattern their life after? There's an attitude that way. You see, the opposite of rejection is projection. I project myself, and I say my gift is the only gift. My place in the body is the only place in the body worth mentioning. Hey, check me out. I'm really something. You see, this was a problem that the church at Corinth had. And this is a problem that Satan would love to inject into our body, making us believe that some are more important than others and making some of us feel like we're the most important thing going. Do you know what? None of us, though we're every one of us important, none of us is indispensable. The only indispensable one is Jesus. The rest of us can be replaced. All of us are important, but none of us are indispensable. You see, that is a very scary concept. There are some who think that the church would fall apart if it weren't for them. Or there could be a group that would say, if it weren't for us, this thing would go belly up. If that is an attitude that is in anyone's heart or mind, that attitude needs to be repented of, recognized, repented of, and replaced with a sense of interdependence and proper appreciation for every other member of the body, and a proper sense of self. Now the eye, and I wasn't in your bulletin, the eye can't say to the hand, I don't need you. And the head can't say to the feet, I have no need of you either. You see, here's the truth. We're in it together. What happens to you impacts me. What happens to me impacts you. What happens to us impacts all of us, which is why it is so important that in this body that we have people growing and people plugging their lives in so that we might be more and more spiritually healthy, so that we might be able to serve our Lord with greater grace, and so that more and more glory would be manifest through our lives, that glory would be reflected from us back to Him for His increasing pleasure. You see, every one of us has a place to play. I'm not arrogant. I'm just better than you. Yeah. You know, that's the way it was at Corinth. That's the attitude that some had. Now, I know we have nobody like that here. I'm sure of that. I'm sure of that. When we look at the cross of Christ, we find our place when we see His sacrifice. You see, if we get to thinking too much of ourselves, the cross of Jesus brings us back to planet Earth with a thud. Yeah. And if we get to thinking that we're low, down, dooby, dooby, down, so low we would have to stand up on a stepladder to scratch the snake's belly, okay? If we get like that, I mean, that's low when you're that low. If we get that kind of low, the cross of Christ reminds us of our value in the sight of God. You see, the cross of Jesus Christ, His sacrifice for us, reminds us of who we are. It reminds us of who we were. It reminds us of who we can be. It reminds us that we do not belong to ourselves, that we have been bought with a price, just like Paul said in 1 Corinthians 6:19-20. What, do you not know that you've been bought with a price? Do you not know that? Do you not know that you've been bought with that price? That's your value. And now you've been placed in the body, and that's your potential. That's the wonderful thing for you, to find your place in God's body, in this body, this local body called Grace Baptist Church. He calls us. He stands with His outstretched arms, the same one whose arms were outstretched like this, and He was crucified on a cross to express His love and willingness to forgive us of our sins and turn us around and make something beautiful out of our lives. This one who was crucified with His arms like this stands with His outstretched hands calling to us, saying, listen, you're mine. Be all I died for you to be. Don't shortchange yourself. And don't shortchange me. Don't diminish the reason for which I died by either rejecting your place or projecting your place as the only place. Find your personal value. Discover your value in me. Make me the center of all that you are. And follow me and allow my spirit to flow through you so that you can be all God wants you to be. My brothers and sisters, that's what it means to be a body of Christ. All fit together. All the parts in harmony. All the parts appreciated. All the parts functioning, all the parts operating in love. What part are you playing? What part do you play? Honestly. We're going to stand and have a verse of reflection upon what we've heard. And we're going to ask, as God speaks to your heart, if you need to make a public kind of decision, we ask that you make it as we sing. Make it privately and then publicly announce it as you're led of God. And if you're a little bit buhaisa and paisa to do something like that, we're very willing to meet you out here on the coffee deck at the conclusion of service and walk with you and love you and pray with you and encourage you to find that wonderful place in this body that only you can fill. Let's stand together. I'm going to pray, then we're going to sing. Father, this invitation time is yours. As we reflect. And as we respond. In Christ's name we offer it to you. Amen.